2010, me and Taisha Jones gave birth to Sincere D'Angelo Hunter. I wasn't able to see him from birth until 5 months because of a crime I committed in 2009 and I was incarcerated. When I first seen a picture of my son, I remember looking at the picture, smiling, and comparing it to one of my friend's pictures when at that age, he was the only one of us that had kids, and his son looked just like him. So when I seen my son, I'm like, dang, on this picture, he looked just like me. So for those 5 months that I didn't see him, I just kept thinking every day, like, man, I could never leave him again. I could never leave him. And like, when I get out, I'm going to be able to just be the best father I can be. I can't leave him. September 12, 2010, I was released, and my mom and sister and Sincere was there to pick me up. My sister was holding my son and he was asleep. And when I first seen him, I was scared to hold him, scared to touch him and everything. And it's funny because when I first asked her, like, what is he doing? She like, he's asleep. I'm like, is he gonna wake up when I pick him up? She like, no, he only been asleep for a little minute, so he probably won't wake up. He just went to sleep. But as soon as I picked him up, he woke up and he gave me this look. And this look he gave me is a look, like, if you know me as like family and friends, you know this look. It's like a look of, who are you? Why are you looking at me? Why are you touching me? And we stared at each other for about, we had to stare down for about 30 seconds. And I don't know if I won or he just got tired of staring at me, but he put his head on his, he put his head on my shoulder and we started to walk out. And I just whispered in his ear, like, I'll never leave you again. And that was one promise that I kept to him. Growing up in the early years, Sincere was a real fearless and exciting kid. Like, the name Sincere, what a definition in the dictionary, Sincere is to be genuine in all pretenses. Sincere was just that. He was a very genuine kid. He never did anything outside of what normal kids do. He was a great kid. He was good. And that stood out from a lot of things. He always was just, he was just genuine in anything he did. As growing up, he excelled in levels that most kids, I'm not going to say wouldn't succeed, but he was at a faster pace. He didn't care about sports in the beginning of years of his life, just like me. When I was younger, I was more electronically stable and loved to read and loved to learn. And that's what he really loved to do. He didn't care about no other things but learning and electronics. He would just sit and watch me either play the game. And like, over time, I bought him games and he played his own games. And he used to just want me to play with him. And it was just like the best thing ever for a father and son relationship to have. He taught me how to be a man, and I taught him how to be a child, and I let him be a child. I never forced him to do things he didn't want. I never put too much pressure on him, and he never put too much pressure on me. It was pressure just in itself of being a father and knowing, like, I have a child out here that I have to take care of. So every movement that I make is really watched in the sense of him even not being there, but just watched. I remember the first time I really realized he was an independent child was when I bought him his first bicycle. He was about 4 years old. And he used to tell me he know how to ride a bike, but I don't know, in my sense, when a person said they know how to ride a bike, even as a kid, I'm thinking like, all right, you can ride a bike with no training wheels. So I bought him a little Mongoose with no training wheels. And I remember he was like, Daddy, where are my training wheels? And I was like, I thought you said you could ride a bike with no training wheels. He's like, I can, but I thought you was going to have some training wheels on there. And he got on the bike. He took about 4 or 5 pedals and fell. And he, like, scraped his leg. And he was, like, whining. He was like, my leg. I'm like, what's wrong? And he like, my leg hurt. And I'm like, what? You want me to kiss it? He like, yeah. So I kissed it, and he was like, it feel better? He like, yeah, feel better. Thank you, daddy. And he got back on his bike, and it was like, he took his time. He was just rolling, man. And that was right there where I was like, man, all it takes is a father's just push, and a father's, like, you know, not guarantee, but a father's just backing it and loving it. And the child will really feel like they could conquer the world, because after that, man, he was standing up, riding the bike with no hands. And I'm just like, man, stop it. He like, I can do this, daddy. And he would ride all the way up and down the street, and it was a pool down the street from my house. So anytime, he loved water, so anytime in the summertime he'd be at my house, we'd go swimming, he'd ride the bike. And I'd be like, why you want to ride the bike? He'd be like, because I could do both at the same time. I could ride the bike, get in the pool, then after that I could get out the pool and ride the bike and play in the park. He loved just being a kid. As he got older, he started to go to, you know, school. He went to my aunt's daycare. I went there, my sister went there, a lot of my family members went there. She's been doing it for about 40 years, and her name's Yvonne Hunter. We call her teacher, and he loved going there. Like, he used to be so excited going there because they did so many curriculum things after school with helping homework, doing homework, helping other kids out. He just loved helping people. I remember his kindergarten promotion to the first grade, when they all asked the kids what they want to do. He got up there and he was like, my name's Sincere Hunter, and I want to be a firefighter. Man, that brought so much joy in my heart, because firefighters really help people and they save people. And that's all he used to want to do. When we would be out and, you know, he'd have on clothes from the well taken care of from his mom or from me, it would be like, he used to ask, like, why do the kid have this, daddy? Why they don't got this? And I used to just tell him, like, man, I don't know, maybe their parents could afford it. He was like, well, can you buy it? I just be like, I can't just buy kids stuff, Sincere. Like, it's not, you know, I just can't get every kid everything. Like, one day we're going to all be able to help each other out, help kids out. But, you know, we just got to take it a day at a time. And he understood what I was saying. I remember when I bought this from, it was his fifth birthday. It was at Build-A-Bear. And I just didn't. I always wanted to give him something that, you know, I know that he could have for him and he could have for himself, and just know that my love is always with him. And as Build-A-Bear, if you're familiar with that, you know, you can leave a voice, and you probably won't be able to understand it, but when you press this, it just basically says, I like to voice my love. I love you, Monkey Boy. And I called him Monkey Boy. That's why I got on the monkey. I called him Monkey Boy because he used to jump on me, want to just climb on stuff. When he went to the park, he'd climb on the monkey bars, and that's just all he wanted to do. And it's like, that's one of the things that I have that keeps me with him, like keeps him with me. Him and my sister, they had a so close relationship. It was like me, my mom, and sister are so close in our section of the Hunter family. The Hunter family is big, but in our section is just us three. That was the first child, grandchild, and nephew, and we all had our different type of, like, relationships. You know, as me being a father, me and him have our own relationship. We was the best friends, and, you know, fathership and sonship. His grandmother, which is my mom, they had their relationship, and his auntie, which is my sister. Him and my sister used to do so much stuff. It was like, sometimes people used to be like, is that her kid? And I'd be like, no, that's my son. They used to be like, man, the way that they react, you would think that that's mother and son. I used to be like, that's, he loved his auntie. Like, he loved all his family members. And his family couldn't do no wrong in his eyes. And that was one thing that I understood with him. Like, he was a strong-minded, willed kid when it came to family, even at a young age. I used to ask him, like, can I go with you and your auntie? He'd be like, no, we going, me and auntie going here, me and TT going to the movies, we going to a party, we going to Jalen party. And that was one of his friends from her friend's kids. And I used to be like, well, why I can't go? And he's like, because I'm going to be back with you when we done. And I was just like, dang, you really independent. Like, you really going to go do what you got to do. But no, you coming back with your dad. Like, it just used to warm my heart. As times got, you know what I'm saying, as he got older, school was just so important to me. His mom, like, we made sure that he was great. Like, she did her best with making sure he did got to school. If she could, if he couldn't get to school, she'd let me know, and then I would get him to school. And if I couldn't, my mom. It was like that triangle of making sure it was great was really like a village raising one child. And I didn't never know how much my son was really loved at times, but he was really loved. And I'm not saying not loved like in a negative aspect. Like, you know, you would see the people, immediate people that you see, but when you would go out places, people like, man, I seen your son at this with his mom, man, that boy look just like you. Like, and that's where it's funny. I used to try clothes on him. I would buy him clothes before I buy myself them. And if he looked right in it, I would go and buy it for myself. I knew that, in a sense, I would look right. But if my son looked right, I would look right, because we look just alike. Like, you wouldn't be able to tell me that he didn't look good in what I bought him or vice versa. And he started to, like, copy off of that. As he got older, he started to be more in tune with dancing, man. Like, hey, my son was a dancer. He had the moves. Like, I put anything up against him on some money, like anything against dancing moves. He used to teach me how to dance, and certain moves that older people as in my age would do, he'd do it. And kids these days, they got swag when they dance, man. And I used to be sitting there like, man, dang, why I got the moves or know how to do it? And he used to just be like, daddy, you just gotta feel it. You gotta feel it. And he'd be like, you concentrating too hard. Like, as a six, seven-year-old kid telling me I'm concentrating hard on dance, and I used to just be laughing like, dang, that's crazy, man. I'm laughing. But, you know, I learned a lot from him. His school, they did so good with him, man. Happy that he went to Apex Academy. I was happy, like, that he went there, because they did a lot. They taught him a lot. And I used to see it in the daily mannerisms of me and him having conversations. He'd come over and do his homework. He would have any troubles like any other kid, but he would love to do his homework. Like, he wouldn't get up until he did it. Sometimes he'd be like, daddy, do I gotta do it right now? Can I get on my iPad and make dance videos? I'd be like, no, you can't make no dance videos unless you read or unless you do your math homework. And he'd be like, all right, he'd do his math homework. I check it, and next thing I know, before I'm even finished checking it, it'd be a dance video made, and I look back at the homework, and the homework would be right. So, I mean, it would be like, hey, what can I say? I'm a proud father. That's this smile you see, man. This smile to light up a room, man, because I have a beautiful smile. And it was like just a splitting image. Like, he smiled, I smiled. And that smile was contagious. If you seen Sincere smile, you would have no choice but to smile, because he was that kid that made you smile. He was just so genuine. He didn't make you upset. He didn't make you want him to do anything wrong. You didn't even want to yell at him, because you would be like, man, this boy is so genuine and just so nice. Why did I yell at him? Why did I do this? But as anything, any kid sometimes need discipline. But I ain't never whipped my son. And I can honestly say, Sincerus probably had got 3 whoopings. And that was probably because I had to, in the sense of him talking back and just being real smart mouth or something. But Sincere never got any whoopings. He was in my eyes, he was a perfect kid. I remember when he was first about to be a big brother to his sister Skylar, he was telling me, he was like, daddy, I'm gonna be the best big brother ever. And I'm just like, how you know? He was like, because I'm a protector. I'm gonna protect my family, I'm gonna protect my mommy, I'm gonna protect you too when I get older, but I'm gonna make sure don't nobody bother my sister Skylar. And it was like, hey, man, you really raw. Like, you really a raw son, man. That was my boy, my best friend. Like, when you seen him, you seen me. And, you know, him and his mom had a great relationship. The way that he felt about his mom was like, it was outstanding. Like, it was really a true mother and son love. Way he felt about his grandma Reese, the way he felt about my mom, it was just like, it was just something that you could just not, it was something that you just couldn't take away. I remember when I was about to have a daughter, he was so excited because he was like, yay, I'm gonna have 2 sisters, you know, and I'm gonna be the big brother. And my daughter name is Siani, and they are like a splitting image of each other. And every time she used to see him at a young age, she's two now, but when she used to see him even at a young age, she used to just be so happy, like kissing him, hugging him, everything. And I used to just be like, man, look at them, man. They don't even get it. They don't even know, like, them or they are, they're the fruits of my flesh that continue to keep my life going, that continue to keep me pushing. And it just was the best thing, like, you know, it was just the best thing to keep it all together. When I got that call, it was like, it was shocking. September 15th, I got that call telling me like to come to the hospital. You know, at a 8-year-old, you don't really think about anything of a high monumental injury that my son was suffering. You was thinking of a broken leg, a broken arm, you know, a finger, anything. And when I first walked into the hospital and I seen, it was like over 35, 40 people, family, friends, and I just couldn't hold it in. And I broke down on the hospital floor in front of everybody. And I remember my mom and his godfather coming over there and telling me like, you know, you got to stand up, you got to get that. And before that, my sister was just talking to me and telling me like, you know, everything gonna be all right, he needs you. And something inside of me was like, get up and go be with your son. And I got up and I went in the hospital room, and this first time seeing my son on that hospital bed, I can't describe it. It's not nothing that I want to describe, and I can't describe it. It was like basically going head on with a brick wall. Something you know you can't beat, something you know you can't defeat. Like, I mean, something you know you can't beat, and something that's just basically defeating you every time you run into it. As I started every day to talk to the doctors, I learned that my son had AVM. AVM is arteriovenous vein malformation. And if you're familiar with, like, the brain or brain injuries in a sense, it's basically equivalent to an aneurysm. An aneurysm, well, AVM, you know, are just snarled tangles of blood vessels or blood veins that, you know, can erupt at any time. That disease is so rare, it's like they don't really focus on it like they would do, you know, if a family member had cancer or diabetes or anything of that nature. It's a 1% chance. And that's how I knew my son was a rare breed. Because what he passed from was rare. Every day in the hospital, the doctors fed me information. And I remember one day the doctor asked me like, Mr. Hunter, are you okay with me feeding you this, like telling you this? And I'm like, yeah, I need to know what's going on with my son. I need to know if my son is ever going to be, you know, back to where I need him to be at. I take everything I need to take. I went and got second options from Boston Children's Hospital, Akron General Hospital. And it was like, at one point in time, if you're familiar with the movie John Q, I'm being all the way honest to you. I felt like I was reenacting that movie because physically at that point in time, I couldn't do anything. I offered, at one meeting, I offered my brain. And I felt like I lived long enough to let my son live enough. If they could have took my brain, I wouldn't be able to do this interview right now. But God had other things planned for me, and I'm here to be able to tell my son's story. Over the course of that month, I lost everything that a person can think. I lost myself. I fell into a deep depression. I second guessed a lot. I felt like I was seeing a lot all those days in the hospital. My dreams wasn't dreams. They were mixed thoughts and things. The reactions from the drugs was giving me and my family false hope that was tearing me down, seeing my mom coming to cry, seeing my sister coming to cry, seeing his mom hold his hand and she just crying, and I'm talking to her and she just not having an answer. Nobody's having an answer. And it's like, even as talking to the doctors, I couldn't give a person an answer because it's not what they wanted to hear. He was loved. Visitors came every day. Every day. We had almost every weekend we had dinner at the hospital. People would bring food that was cooked, and we would just as a family have dinner, and we was just always here for Sincere, and that's what it was. We was here for Sincere, and we still here for him today. October 11th, this was only the one time I went home. I went to work a couple times, but I came right back. Now, this was the one time that I had went home, and I don't know, my body was just like, my mind was just telling me, go home, go home. And when I went home, before I went home, me and the doctors was talking, and at this time, they had took the trachea out of his throat and the drainage tube out of his brain, and we were trying to see if he would breathe on his own for a second. And immediately when they took him off of it, his breathing had started to go down. He wasn't breathing regularly, so they had to hook him back up. And the doctor started to explain to me the complications that were really starting to happen. We didn't see it, but my son was continuously having brain seizures over and over and over and over again. And it was like, we didn't see it, but my son continued to be suffering. His body continued to be in pain, his mind, his everything was in pain, but we couldn't feel it. As a father, again, I have felt like I failed because I couldn't save my son or physically help him out in the sense of how I needed to help him out. And she had told me, you know, if it doesn't get better, he would have to go through a surgery. And if not, you know, we would have to think of other options. I never thought that other options would be that next day, October 12th. October 12th, I woke up. It was a regular day. I felt different because I wasn't at the hospital. So I got right up, got in the shower, and was just, you know, just getting myself together. And his mom called me, and I had missed her call. So when I had got out the shower, I called her back. And after calling her back, she didn't answer. So while I'm getting dressed, she called, and I instantly hear her voice crackling. And I told her, look, don't talk, I'm on my way. I got up there in about 15 minutes. And when I got up there, that she was in the room. I don't know what the room is called, but it's the room like where, you know, the family is there for like the grieving. And it was just her. And I just seen her face. And then I sat down and I was asking her, what's up? And she was just like, man, not getting no better. And, you know, I let her vent and I asked her, what do you want to do? I had already knew what I wanted to do in my mind, but I wanted it to be a agreeable thing and not a forceful, or felt like it was forced. And she said, I don't want him to suffer. And I said, me neither. As a father, your job is to make sure that your child is taken care of mentally and physically by all means. And mentally, I helped him out in the best way I could have. We both agreed to let him go because it would have been selfish for us to continue to let my son be in that comatic state and continue to suffer from something that research and doctors don't have an answer for. And I wasn't gonna let him suffer. So we called all family members up and friends, and they came and they, you know, said their goodbyes. About 11:50, I had went in his room. It was me, my mom, her mom, a couple family friends. I don't remember her aunt Betsy, the doctor, and his godfather. As they started to remove the breathing machine, I got in the bed with my son, and I held him take his last breath. I put my head on his heart. I put my head on his heart and let him and listen to those last heart beats. And every beat, I lost energy. I lost train of thought. I lost direction. I lost everything that you can imagine losing a child. And at that last heartbeat, it was like, I felt like my life was over. I didn't care about living. I had thoughts of suicide. And over time, I fought through it and I prayed. And I remember the last thing I told him, he loved Spider-Man, he loved superheroes. I had put on this brand new Spider-Man outfit. I got him dressed. That was the only deceased body I ever seen, ever held. And I never want to do that, but for it to be my child, I mean, I'm not gonna say I'm proud, but I'm proud. Putting on this Spider-Man outfit, I knew that he was always my superhero. And he didn't probably understand when I used to tell him, like, you my superhero, you my hero. And that meant, like, I looked up to him in the sense of him putting me in the manner of knowing that I have to be this man that I have to be. I have to be the best that I could be to provide for him and to provide for my other kids. He didn't even know that he was having a brother because we was going to surprise him. He always had said he wanted a little brother, and he didn't. He wasn't able to, you know, meet him, but Blessing, that's his brother's name, Blessing. And that's because he is a blessing. He was born 4 days after his brother passed, which was October 16th, but he was born at 10/12, which is October 12th. And I feel like, in a sense, he came back to me and just to let me know, like, Daddy, everything gonna be all right. You're gonna be the best that you can be. After his passing and after the funeral, I fell into a real deep depression. I suffered from post-traumatic stress and anxiety, which I still suffer from that today. But I'm fighting for it and I'm fighting through it. I went and finally, you know, follow my dreams of being on the radio. Always wanted to be a radio personality. And as of today, which is December 9th, I will be 3 days from graduating from Ohio Media School. And that's for him. It's for me, but that's for him, because one thing I did promise him was I was going to follow all my dreams. And everything that I ever promised him, I'm going to do. I told him I'd never let his voice die. And that's where Sincerest Angels came from. Sincerest Angels is an outreach program to children and a research group for families that suffer, or family members that suffer from aneurysms or AVM. I don't ever want a family to feel like how I feel, and I want to be able to do anything I can to help them out. I got this shirt, and I'm gonna frame this shirt. This shirt, this the last shirt that my son had on. This is one of the last shirts that he had of something that I had purchased him. This the shirt that he had got rushed to the hospital in. This is a shirt. It says blood and stuff on it, and you know, this is like blood in, blood out. But this would never leave my side. He'll always be with me and always be with his family. And I never let nobody know that I have this. So excuse me. I keep it tight knit until I get the right time, because it's gonna have his name and everything at the bottom when I frame it.
I always just
sit back and think about everything that transpired in those, 8 years of having them, and I can't really do nothing but sit back and laugh and sit back and smile, because he really, 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 really was a blessing to know him. It was really a blessing to be his father. And it was really just a sincere thing for him to be in my life. And he lived a sincere life. And he couldn't have had a better name. Trouble tea, they'll land you in. Open your eyes, it's all a disguise. The fear that you feel is not real. Not real. The fear that you feel is not real. No. My son gon' be a king, I tell him every morning. I put my chain on his neck, right now it's heavy on him. One day it all'll be his, so I'm forever on him. I test him all the time, and I never want him. I pop quiz him like stop listening, drop wisdom. Pop's vision, the bottom's crowded, the top isn't. We talk WAP missions, cops prison. I help him see it clearly, I'm his life optician. Can learn from my experience, but youngin' gotta live. Cause not with that mentality, that's something gotta give. Cause that's how we grew up, probably should've picked for boogers. Nah, we was on them streets, jugging for that mugger. Still, scared that you still could get killed. That fear that you feel was that real. But I'm near like I will not get killed. So that fear that I feel is not real, boy. I'm a true king, trying to raise a new king. I wanna show him stuff, teach him how to do things. How to ride a bike, how to tie shoestrings. How to be a man, how to treat his boo thing. Gotta have an OG, give you that go head. I don't blame you niggas, I blame your old head. I know all about that, my papa wasn't down. Papa used to come through, papa doesn't now. Should've protected me, but papa wasn't round. So now I got this nine that papa doesn't round. Them kids grow up quick, usually grow you up too. Turn you to a big dog, that's what having pups do. Did a lot, but I know that I ain't done yet. Before it goes down, I make sure that my